Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Soldiers Without Borders, Beyond the SAS, a global network of brothers in arms. Written by Ian McPhedran and read by Peter Byrne. The dedication reads, For Verona and Lucy. Acknowledgements. This book could not have been written without my wife, Verona Burgess. Not only is she an incisive editor, she's also a boundless source of ideas and inspiration. Once again, we've been able to produce a book together and remain happily married. Our daughter Lucy took the long absences of her dad in her stride, and my stepkids Daniel and Jenna Cave were keen supporters. I received generous help and guidance from several ex-SAS men, but none more so than Terry O'Farrell, who is a fine example of what the regiment is all about. The wonderful hospitality that I enjoyed from Terry, Lee and Liam made my trips to the Middle East feel like family visits. Ken Webb was a source of encouragement and inspiration. Jim Truscott and Pete Tinley provided plenty of ideas. George and his wife, Audrey, gave very generously of their time and friendship. I thank George for raking over some grim experiences. Rob Jamieson in the UK provided insights and ideas. Thanks to Dave Harper in Dubai for his help and hospitality. I'm grateful to Terry Cully in Auckland for introducing me to many great blokes from the New Zealand SAS. And thanks also to Pete Bradford and his wife, Wendy. I'm deeply indebted to all the former soldiers who bared their souls, particularly the counter-terrorism pioneers who deserve closure. David Horner's wonderful official history of the SAS, SAS Phantoms of War, continues to be a valuable reference tool. My sister Jane provided shelter during my many visits to Perth, and thanks also to my other sisters Lynn and Cheryl, brother Sean and dad Colin. Thanks also to my sister-in-law, Adrienne Burgess, and her husband, Martin Cochran, for their kindness and succour at the marvellous Pimlico guesthouse. Jeanette Doolan and Liz Kemp provided very professional and timely help with their transcriptions. Once again, I am indebted to my employer, News Limited, for its tolerance and forbearance. Finally, to Shona Martin and her terrific team at HarperCollins, particularly Mel Kane, Jennifer Blau, and Christine Farmer. Many thanks. Ian McPhedran, Sydney, June 2008. Introduction. One of the biggest challenges facing the Special Air Service in the uncertain post-9/11 world has been to hold on to its highly trained soldiers. This extraordinary group of Australians work in a shadowy but tremendously rewarding occupation, and taxpayers invest a huge amount of money in their special skills. In my first book, The Amazing SAS, many men of the SAS opened up about their exploits from the time of the 1999 East Timor crisis to the 2003 Iraq War. Their personal tales and insights, which they shared with generosity of spirit, were about extreme soldiering and how to apply strategic force while maintaining humility and humour. Yet, since 2003, many of them have resigned to pursue other opportunities in a borderless marketplace where their skills are in high demand. Ever since World War II, there's been a trickle of special forces operatives who've moved out to pursue other interests, but that trickle has become a torrent in the early years of the 21st century. In Iraq alone, there are more than 40,000 private security contractors, and the best paid of those are former Tier 1 Special Forces operators from Australia, Britain, and the US. Hundreds more are working in Afghanistan, Africa, and Southeast Asia, and in many other parts of the world, applying their unique abilities to a variety of highly paid jobs. I wanted to know more about what our former elite soldiers were doing in these often obscure pockets of the world, and how they were finding life beyond the SAS. So I raised the idea of this book with Terry O'Farrell. Terry left the SAS himself in 2004, after a 38-year army career mostly spent in the regiment. including two tours of duty in the Vietnam War. He's now a full colonel and deputy commander of special operations for the government of the United Arab Emirates. He liked the idea for a new book, and he offered some unique perspectives. The Middle East is the current center of the action for serving and former Special Forces soldiers, and Terry and his team are right at the heart of it. One of them was George, a senior operator whom we met in the amazing SAS during his time in East Timor and Afghanistan, and a ferocious networker. Soon, emails were flying around the world, and my initial list of names jotted on the back of an envelope grew into a long catalogue of those who were prepared to share their stories, including some upon whom fortune has not smiled as kindly as she has on heroes of the most recent conflicts. A strong theme quickly emerged. Wherever they are, and whatever they do, these former SAS soldiers are linked by a bond that is forged during their time in the elite regiment. The new information age has also enabled them to keep in touch as never before, contributing to the creation of a shadowy and increasingly valuable global network of former brothers-in-arms that reaches across generations and national borders. It is a network that is made all the stronger by their common experience of the grueling SAS selection course, which requires each successful candidate to leave his old self behind and step forward into a new life. So, as I set out in late 2006 to discover more about what ex-SAS men get up to after they walk out the gate of Campbell Barracks in Perth, I was very lucky to meet up again with some of the great characters whom I encountered as I researched the first book. They were very generous with their time and hospitality, as well as opening doors into the wider network. Whether it was in a small hamlet outside Hobart, or amongst the concrete, steel and glass fantasy of Dubai, or in a London pub, I found an incredible and ever-expanding network of these former troops linked together across the globe, and all of them with terrific stories to tell. That is how the theme of Soldiers Without Borders emerged. As one former SAS man told me, it doesn't matter where he is or what he's doing. A quick call on Skype will connect him to dozens of mates. In some places, such as Dubai International Airport, they can literally collide with one another in the check-in queue. The Chief of the Australian Defence Force, Air Chief Marshal Angus Houston, is more aware than most of how difficult it is to keep Special Forces soldiers stimulated and in the service of the Commonwealth. "I hold them in the very highest regard," he told me in March 2008. "I think they are arguably the best Special Forces in the world. They are certainly the creme de la creme as far as we're concerned, and they do a magnificent job for us, and therefore I'm very keen to retain as many of them as I can." Houston is a realist about the fact that the lure of big dollars in the global security market has taken a particularly heavy toll on the regiment. But he also knows that money does not always compensate them for the support network and the standard of professional excellence of the SAS. He is keen to see SAS operators re-enlist once they have tried their hands in the outside world. He also recognises that keeping SAS soldiers interested and rewarded is a major task. "They are very talented people, very highly trained, and you don't get into Special Forces unless you are an adaptable soldier. And I guess the other thing about the Special Forces people is they're always wanting to improve themselves. There's a great desire to achieve the maximum amount of self-improvement to attain higher skill levels. So their professional standards are very high, and they are second to none." In conducting the interviews for this book, I found that that desire for excellence continues to drive former SAS men, able-bodied or not, in their new lives, whether working as security operators in Iraq, crisis managers in Africa, corporate risk advisors, small businessmen, politicians, ministers of religion, or even stand-up comics. Their tales are diverse and fascinating, as are their reflections on the military life that made them the people they are today. Every quote is genuine, chosen from dozens of interviews conducted during 2006, 2007, and 2008. Where possible, I have used full names. 3. Ray Jones, Rob Jamison, and Audrey are pseudonyms. George, Grant, Steve, Chris and Willie could only be identified by their first names for reasons of national security. Prologue. Awakening. The oily waters of the South China Sea lapped against the side of the tramp steamer as she chugged north towards her destination. Standing against the rail, gazing out into the moonless night, Ray Jones wondered what the hell he'd got himself into. The former Australian SAS officer had only taken on the job as a favour to a mate, but it had been a shit sandwich from day one. Even the fact that it was a clandestine task, an important national security operation to collect a deadly secret military cargo on behalf of Western governments, couldn't lift his spirits. Jones knew the score with deniable operations that were sanctioned secretly at the highest levels. If they turned to custard and the cover was blown, the powers that be would simply deny everything and disown all involved, from the military down to the spooks, and at the bottom of the food chain, hired guns like him. After breaking down in the Java Sea, the vessel had safely negotiated one of the busiest and most pirate-prone waterways in the world, the Malacca Strait, between Malaysia and the Indonesian island of Sumatra, and was now heading gingerly through the tepid, tropical waters. Jones and his offsider were supposed to be the security detail on board, in case pirates or anyone else decided to raid it. Asia's seaways are riddled with gangs of marine criminals, equipped with fast boats, GPS and satellite phones, who hit private and merchant vessels and rob, kill or cast adrift all souls. Jones wasn't too bothered about pirates. He had enough firepower at his disposal to dampen even the most daring swashbuckler sailing under the Jolly Roger. Besides, the government men who were on board to oversee the operation would provide plenty of muscle should he require backup. What was eating away at him was the fact that here he was, back on bloody gunfighter detail. He knew he should be in a boardroom somewhere, selling his education and military expertise to corporate high flyers or governments, not wet-nursing some half-assed freighter and her motley crew. The ship's master was a former Navy man who, Jones thought, obviously couldn't cut it in Her Majesty's senior service and had washed up on this rust bucket. He had taken an instant dislike to Jones and his mate and had made life a misery at every turn, treating the security detail like deckhands rather than as the professionals they were. Jones knew that keeping to himself as much as possible would be the key to getting through the weeks that stretched out in front of him. He decided then and there that this would be his final turn as a gunslinger. The vessel arrived in port, and the owners came on board. After a few days alongside, there was suddenly a sense of urgency. Several plain wooden crates were transferred from a nearby ship and stacked neatly on the wharf. Inside was a new missile system, ready to be transported, supposedly, to a buyer in the Middle East. The highly sensitive cargo was loaded onto the steamer, and she put to sea on a westwards course towards an Arab port. But several days later, she swung about and made for her real destination. An agent from a Western government's overseas spy organization, under the guise of a Middle Eastern arms dealer, had brokered a deal with corrupt elements inside a foreign, potentially unfriendly military service to buy the weapon. Instead of heading to that troubled region, it would be shipped to an Allied Powers research facility, where its brand new guidance system would be investigated, isolated, and stolen. On this leg of the voyage, Jones and his team were placed on intensive 24-hour watch, not just for pirates, but for any hostile government ships as well. Fortunately, the voyage proceeded without a hitch, and sometime later, the vessel hove to off a port. A fast, friendly Navy vessel soon pulled up alongside, and the cargo was transferred for shipment to Allied laboratories where scientists waited to unlock its secrets. Within days, valuable data concerning the weapon system would be on its way to its real Western destination, where countermeasures would be developed. After more than 2 months on the hot, stinking vessel, Jones was delighted to bid farewell to the steamer and her bizarre skipper. While he kicked himself for taking the job in the first place, the contract had taught him many lessons, the foremost being that he was too old to be carrying a gun on dubious jobs. "Essentially, I was no longer prepared to put up with idiots," he says. He vowed that the boardroom, and not the wardroom, was where he would operate from then on. 6 years on, Ray Jones, not his real name, has built a successful international business and can laugh about his days on the tramp steamer. In his new role as a chief executive, he's always on the lookout for talent, former SAS colleagues, whose qualifications might include extreme service in deniable operations under deep cover in the post-9/11 hunt for Islamic terrorists. These jobs are at the so-called Tier 1 end of the Special Forces spectrum and include such tasks as providing security for agents from government overseas spying agencies and collecting human intelligence to help track down some of the world's most powerful terrorists through small paramilitary groups operating outside the diplomatic safety net. Jones knows that it is only a matter of time before some of these Tier 1 specialists reach the end of their time in the SAS and start looking for opportunities elsewhere. He also knows that sooner or later, a client will require an operative with this unique skill set. In the post-9/11 world, many former SAS soldiers are working in hazardous or challenging jobs in new careers and businesses, spanning the continents in a strategic environment that was unimaginable a decade ago. They are part of a growing global network in what to them has become a borderless world. War Horses. Chapter 1. African Nightmare. The brand new white BMW 325 CI hits 160 kilometres an hour as it zooms along one of Abu Dhabi's numerous eight-lane freeways. The fit, olive-skinned driver's eyes are smiling behind his designer shades, and he has not a care in the world. Life doesn't get any better than this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.